Hello dear chess friends, this is international chess grandmaster Nadezhda Kosintseva for chesslecture.com, and today I'm going to continue the discussion of the Ragozin defense. Let's get started to see. D4, knight f6, c4, e6, knight f3, d5, knight c3, Bishop b4, entering into the Ragozin defense. So, in my previous lecture, we analyzed what is the difference between playing bishop g5 immediately and taking on d5 first and then playing bishop g5. And also, we analyzed the main line after c takes on d5, e takes on d5, bishop g5, knight b on d7, rook c1. So today we are going to analyze e3 move. Again, I play c5 as in the case of rook c1 and bishop b5. This move is a pretty rare one, but if you are going to play the Ragozin defense, you should be ready to remember some important ways how to counterplay for the black side after this move. Queen a5. Again, this move is a very important one for the Ragozin defense, and the main way how to counterplay for the black this position. I'm threatening to play knight e4, so for this reason white should take on f6, and I'm not going to take the bishop on f6 with my pawn, because in this case I will have double pawns and in the future will have very unsafe king. So instead I'm going to take the bishop on b5 using the pin between white knights and white's king. So white takes on g7. I play rook g8, white plays bishop e5, I should take the pawn on g2, and now bishop g3. So this position is a critical one. On the first glance it seems pretty dangerous for black due to the position of the rook on g2. However, thanks to the tactical ideas, black may organize effective counterplay on the queen side. And by the way, as you will see in many variations, the rook on g2 helps to attack rather than being a weakness. So I play knight f6. Again, I'm going to play knight e4, bishop g4. If white allows me to do it. Of course, white does not want to be pinned after bishop g4, so they are going to play knight e5. Another idea of this move is to play queen f3 and capture my rook on g2. If instead of knight e5, white plays, for example, knight h4, going to capture my rook immediately, I have very important tactical idea. I play bishop g4 first, and now the main idea is to checkmate on e2 square. For example, white cannot play queen b3 now due to immediate checkmate queen e2. Okay, so they should choose between queen d2 or queen c2. If white plays queen d2, for example, because of my queen is hanging now, I just play queen a6, sacrificing my rook. And my idea that if white takes my rook, I play knight e4, attacking the white's king, and after queen c2, I take the knight on c3, b takes on c3, bishop takes on c3, White should take my bishop on c3, and again I checkmate on e2 square. So if in this position white plays queen c2 instead of queen d2, again I use the same tactical idea. I take the pawn on d4 first, white takes on d4, and I play rook c8, again with the idea to checkmate on e2 square. For example, if white takes my rook, I take with the rook, and after b takes on c3, I take on c3 with a check. Queen should take on c3, and again queen e2 checkmate. So it is one important tactical idea that we can use in this bishop b5 line. So another option for white is, instead of playing knight e5, is to play queen b3, for example, trying to prepare long castle. So in this case, again I'm going to play bishop g4, and after long castle I should be able to find very important move c4, and after knight takes my queen on b5, I'm going to sacrifice an exchange. I should take the queen on b3, and after knight c7 check, king e7, knight takes the rook, b takes on a2, king c2 the only move to prevent my pawn for the promotion. I take the knight on f3, and I still enough compensation for the exchange due to the strong pawn on a2, two bishops, and very active position in spite of the fact that my rook is still on g2. I'm going to play knight e4, take the bishop on g3, and then my rook will be able to include in the game. Okay, let's go back to knight e5 move. It is the main line for the white. Bishop g3, knight e5, and again it is very logical move, because white tried to occupy the center with their pieces. They're preparing queen f3 move, so I should act very vigorously to create counterplay on the queen side. Okay, I play knight e4, rook c1. If white plays queen f3 immediately, I need first to defend the pawn on f7, playing bishop b6, and if white takes my rook on g2, I play knight takes on c3, bishop takes on c3, b takes on c3, bishop takes on c3, king d1 and queen b2, threatening to checkmate on d2 square, and there is no way for white to escape this checkmate. For example, if they play knight f3, I just play bishop g4, pinning white's pieces, and I'm still threatening to checkmate on d2. Let's go back. So instead of playing queen f3, white play rook c1 first. So now I should take on d4. White takes on d4 with a pawn. In the case if white takes on d4 with a queen, I should take on c3 first, white takes on c3 with a pawn, and then I play f6. Uh, Knight goes on d3, bishop goes on g4, with the idea bishop f3, and after knight f4, bishop f3, white cannot take my rook on g2 due to checkmate on e2 square. And again, I have a lot of option to continue my attack. I'm going to play rook c8, rook c4, and my position looks very good. So for this reason, white takes on d4 with the pawn. And I play bishop e6, preparing for the queen f3 move, defending my pawn on f7. Queen e2. It is another important position of the bishop b5 line. If instead of playing queen e2, white plays queen f3 now, again, I'm going to use the same tactical idea. I'm going to sacrifice my rook on g2. I'm going to play rook c8. And after queen takes on g2, I takes on c3 with the knight first, and after b takes on c3, I take with the rook, and we'll checkmate white's king in few moves. Rook takes on c3, bishop takes on c3, king d1 is the only move, queen b1, king e2, queen c2, king e3, bishop d2, king f3, bishop e4. So I have a rook down, but I checkmate the opponent because of the power of my bishop and the queen. So let's go back and analyze queen e2 move instead of playing queen f3. Queen e2. So, as I said, it is another critical position of the variation. Black now have a choice between two options. They can play queen b6, queen a5, or they can just exchange the queens, taking white's queen on e2. So let's take a look on all of them, because they are pretty equal. So let's begin with let's start with queen a5. So queen a5 looks pretty logical, because I continue to create pressure on c-file, on knight on c3. It would be the great move, but white has very crazy tactical idea. They can take my pawn on f7 with the idea if I take on f7 with the king, they check and they will take my rook. And in this position I don't have enough compensation and I don't have any checkmate. So if I take with the bishop instead of taking with the queen, white plans to play king f1, attacking my rook. So there is nothing better than to take my bishop on g3 now. And in spite of the fact that black has two pieces for the rook, usually it's enough, but in this position, because of weakness of their king, because of unsafety of the king, white have an advantage. For example, if bishop takes on c3, I takes on c3 with the rook, and then I'm threatening to take the pawn on h7, and my position is better. So, for this reason, after knight takes on f7, the best way for black is to take on c3 first. And I should take with the pawn now, and again I take on f7 with the bishop, and after king f7, rook takes on g3, h takes on g3, I have better position comparing with the previous one when white had a rook on c3 instead of having pawn on c3. And the position is still very complicated. It's unclear position and it promises interesting dynamic play for both sides. So it is one option for black. Let's see another option. So another option after queen e2 is to play queen b6. Queen b6. Now if white takes on f7, the similar idea. I have better position due to some reason. I take on c3, b takes on c3, again I take with the bishop, king goes on f1 attacking my rook, I should take the bishop on g3, h takes on g3, and again comparing this position with the previous one, the difference that I have the important move queen g6, I'm defending my pawn on h7, additionally I'm going to long castle, I'm preparing my long castle, and position is much better for black now. So for this reason knight f7 does not work so well, so but white can play knight d3, for example, with the idea knight f4 attacking my rook with the knight. I play king f8, preparing rook e8 move, and after knight f4, rook e8, knight takes my rook, I'm going to take the bishop first, and after h takes on g3, I play bishop g4. White should take my rook, I take the queen with my queen. Short castle, queen takes on d4, and the position again is very complicated with dynamic chances for both sides, and it is another option how to react on queen e2 move. So the last one is to exchange the queens. So the last one is to take the queen on e2. White should take with the king. I should take the knight first. B takes on c3. F6. So knight should go on d3. If white attack my rook with the king, I just take on g3 and then take with the knight, and then game. My two pieces will worth more than a rook of the white. So knight goes on d3. Bishop g4 check. King e3 and king f7, again preparing rook e8 move, meaning white's king. So knight f4, if white plays f3, I just play rook e8. Knight f4, I take the bishop on g3, now white should take my rook on g2, they cannot play h takes on g3 because I'm going to play rook e8, king d3, bishop f5, and again I checkmate white's king after king d2, rook takes on f2, king d1, bishop g4 with a checkmate. So after knight takes on g3, white takes my rook on g4, I take the rook on h1, white takes the rook on h1, and the position should be about the equality. I can just play rook c8, we have the same amount of pawns, and the position is pretty equal. So, both of these options are pretty interesting and they require additional analysis, but the main thing about all of them is that they all promise pretty interesting and very dynamic game. So, summarizing today's lecture, I would conclude that after bishop b5, black has enough counterplay to compensate the dangerous position of the rook on g2. So the most important thing for the black side after bishop b5 is to remember the most important tactical ideas and act as vigorously as possible to create counterplay. That's it for today. It was Nadezhda Kosintseva for chesslecture.com.